So nobody can be allowed to perpetuate the marginalization. And that's why we have, for example, equalization fund was provided for to basically help those other areas to come closer to the other areas which had been advantaged. At the same time, you do not want to hold the other areas that you should now mark time and wait for these other areas to come and catch up. So you need to allow these other areas also to grow, okay? So what you're talking about is not equality, you're talking about equity. Equity in terms of allocation of resources. And that's the reason why Commission for Revenue Allocation was created in the Constitution. But that commission looks at several factors and comes up with a formula to allocate resources to ensure that no particular region suffers under development. That is the work of the CRA. Now, when I wrote an article, I talked about CRA. At that time, I just come back from Dubai. I did not even know that the CRA report had been changed by the committee of parliament. Okay? It had been changed, and counties were benefiting at the expense of others. Yes. Now, but the reason why this was happening is because the government, because of the state of the economy today, was not adding more money to the counties. It's stuck at 316 billion shillings. And this is in a 3 trillion budget. So that is about 10%. Yet the Constitution has said minimum 15%. Okay? When we were discussing during this BBI, we were proposing to increase it to 35%. And then, you see, the other problem which nobody's mentioning is that there are several functions which have been devolved, but which are still being held by the national government. And because of this, the funds are being held at the national government and are not available down there. And that's why you see that a lot of money that is being devolved goes to recurrent rather than development, okay? But if we devolve more funds, then percentage of recurrent will be smaller compared to the percentage that will go for development in the counties, okay? But then it is the issue of equity. So what was proposed, what we are proposing, was that it should not be a winner and a loser. It should be a win-win situation right now. And that's the reason why the amendment was being proposed that you do not implement any formula now until more resources are made available. So the counties, no county will lose. Each county will get the same amount of money they got in the last financial year as you're working to this. Now, if you look at the formula which the CRA has now come up with, because the CRA has modified the formula that was introduced about three or four years ago. They have a reduced amount, percentage that goes to population. But they have introduced other factors like health, services, they have introduced things, agriculture, and so on and so forth. Okay? This itself has caused, is the source of these complaints. The other counties are arguing rightly. They don't have agriculture, for example. They're pastoralists, most of them. Pastoralism is a way of life. They have got livestock. So that livestock also need to, when you are considering agriculture, you should also consider livestock as an economic activity. That's right. Then there's also blue economy. The counties in the coast have blue economy involved. The counties in the west, western Nyanza, and part of western province have a blue economy in the lake. That has not been factored. The mineral activities, there are counties which have got minerals, like Kitui is an example, Taita Taveta, Kwale, Kilifi, and so on. That has not been factored. So that's why we are saying that CRA should go back to the drawing board and look at that formula again afresh and take some of these economic activities into account. That may come up with a more balanced distribution of resources than is the case at the moment. Yeah.
Now is ideal, where there is no clear distinction between who is in the opposition and who is in government.
I don't agree that the position is weak. So people have not understood the system of government that we adopted now, as compared to, you know, we had a parliamentary system before. Now we have got a presidential system. A presidential system, power is divided between executive, legislature, and judiciary. Now, the legislature oversights the executive as a whole. In other words, even the members of the party in government who are in parliament also oversight the government. It's not adversarial, is it, the way it is in the Westminster type, where you've got opposition benches and government benches. And the opposition is now the one that is oversighting the government. In a presidential system, the legislature as a whole has a responsibility to oversight the government. That's why you've got those committees in the House where membership is shared. And those committees, like you've got Health Committee, you've got Finance Committee, you've got Agriculture Committee, you've got Education Committee, and the membership are from both sides. Those committees are oversighting those sectors. You see? So this is something that even the media has not understood in this country. You see? So there's nothing like opposition is weak here. Parliament is weak as an institution, in my view. That's what it is.
But if you look at the dysfunction, for example, in the country that has perfected the presidential system, what's happening between the Republicans and the Democrats vis-a-vis President Trump. do you think is there any likelihood, for example, that the Republicans will be openly critical of Trump? So, and there are dangers then, even this system, in the assumption that Parliament as a corpus, as a whole, would oversight the executive?
Yeah, you see, in the US, you will find sometimes Republican members talking critical of the government. Huh? You, like, you saw that impeachment, there was a Republican member who voted.
Yes, yes, yes.